the connection of Christie and the Mets right now is somewhat appropriate given how the Mets are playing. But yeah, Chris Christie can't find his way away from bad news. No matter where he turns, he finds himself in a difficult position. And what I find so interesting about him is he doesn't appear to be hiding from the spotlight at all.
No.
But given his poll numbers and how difficult things are for him, he finds a way to get himself in front of cameras and in the news without much effort. It's a weird thing. I'm very interested to see where his career progresses because...
Well, Ryan... That's what I was just going to ask you. I'm hearing that he's one of the possible replacements for a New York sports radio show in New York City, obviously, in the afternoon drive slot there, and that he's seriously being considered and really wants the job. And I just can't believe that you go from governor. They talked about him maybe being a vice presidential candidate. He was going to be on Trump's cabinet. Now he's fighting for a radio gig. You know, no disrespect to anyone in the industry, but I think it's a step backwards. I could be wrong.
Well, he'll probably be making a little bit more
than us.
That's
a pretty prominent radio gig. I mean, that's one of the best radio gigs in the country.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty big.
Go even one step back, Jeff. This guy, in 2012, when Mitt Romney just couldn't catch on, they were begging him to run for president. Mm-hmm. Republicans were dying for Chris Christie to come and rescue the ticket because they knew they had no shot at beating Barack Obama, and he decided that it wasn't the right time for him to run. He was going to hold off and wait and run in 2016. His presidential campaign was a disaster. But I also think that Christie played a huge role in Donald Trump winning the nomination. I remember being in Houston, Texas, the day before the Republican debate down there, and Christie had just dropped out. This was after the New Hampshire primary, before the South Carolina primary. And he made an announcement. He was holding a press conference. He held that press conference, and Donald Trump popped out, and he endorsed Donald Trump. And that was the first real mainstream Republican to endorse Donald Trump. And that's when we all kind of looked at each other and thought, boy, Donald Trump could win the Republican nomination. Yeah. So, Donald Trump still owes him a debt of gratitude, and there is still a good chance that he ends up in the Trump administration in some capacity down the road.
I got to tell you, sometimes when Trump talks about Christie, he does it in almost a demeaning way, joking about him. And Trump, if you're the joke, Trump he'll pile on. And I think kind of done that with Chris Christie here. Okay, so the president making the statement that, listen, I think we're just going to let Obamacare die and then we'll fix it. What's the general thought there on Capitol Hill after not being able to get this done?
You know, it's such a weird time to be on Capitol Hill because usually what happens with these lawmakers who've been around there for a long time is that they always figure something out. When it looks like there are no options left on the table, they somehow come up with some sort of plan that just gets enough support to get across the finish line. And that's the exact opposite is happening right now. I mean, everybody you talk to just does not seem to have an answer as to where the path forward is with healthcare. I mean, the divide is so big between Republicans and Democrats, and it's almost just as big between conservative and moderate Republicans. And when there's just no common thread that unites them all, it is hard to imagine a scenario where they do something. And so I think that right now, Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader, has his back up against the wall. I don't think that Donald Trump necessarily understands the legislative process, and so he's just kind of throwing out statements that don't have a lot of substance behind them and are frankly not really helping that process at all. So I don't know what their next move is. The Majority Leader wants to bring the bill to the floor for a vote. There's a chance that it won't even make it through the first hurdle, which is just not a vote to approve the bill, but just to get it on the floor for debate. They might not even get that far. And it is so rare, especially in this era of legislative politics, for a majority leader or a speaker of the House to bring a bill to the floor that they know is going to fail. So, I don't know. They're going to have lunch today at the White House, but where this goes, I don't think anybody can forecast.
Yeah, yeah. And does this become a real problem for Republicans in the midterms? Which, by the way, our campaigns are already underway for the midterms. We're seeing it right here in the 22nd congressional district. But do you what do you think?
I think that's exactly the problem, Bill, that health care has become a political problem and not a policy problem.
Mm-hmm.
And Republicans are so scared of losing control of the Congress that, you know, in each one of these individual districts and in each one of these individual states, depending on what the mood is of your constituents, you do not want to move an inch on health care. So if you're in a moderate or swing district, you do not want to be the vote that decides that there are going to be Medicaid cuts down the road. But if you're in a hard right district, you do not want to be the vote that allows Obamacare to stay in place in some form or fashion.
Yeah.
And so the problem with that is when something as important as health care becomes a political problem and not a policy problem, people are going to suffer. And I'm not here to advocate for or against Obamacare. Obviously, people can have thoughts about that. But there is a fundamental problem right now in the insurance market that it is the responsibility of our lawmakers in Washington to fix. They seem to be more interested in whether or not they get elected, and no one is willing to take a hard vote to deal with the reality of this situation. And as a result, people are going to suffer. That's not a, you know, that's not hyperbole. People are going to suffer because this problem is not going to be solved.
You know, I find it's, is this new? I mean, when we look back through history, it almost seems that the sole purpose of Congress is to make moves that allow them to remain in office or get back into power. That is, and that's exactly what we're seeing. Healthcare is a perfect example of that.
Well,
why not get together and fix it? Well, here's why. Because if we fix it, our constituents will be happy and everything's going to stay put. The Democrats will remain out of the majority. If you don't fix it, maybe the Republicans will get blamed. And this is all that is being talked about and thought of right now, it seems.
Well, I'll clarify that point. You're right. But make no mistake that members of Congress have always made decisions based on whether or not they were going to be reelected. That's never changed.
Yep.
The difference is in the Tip O'Neill era and the Tip O'Neill Ronald Reagan compromise era of politics, and even before that, you were rewarded by your constituents for being someone who was willing to compromise and was willing to make deals and was willing to reach across the aisle for the betterment of the American people. I mean, I think you look back at the career of Sherry Bowler in Utica. He was the prime example of the old school member of Congress who was not afraid to buck his party at a time where he thought that it would make the most sense for his constituents. And he was rewarded time and time again and reelected year after year after year. We now live in an era of politics which is primarily driven by the gerrymandering of districts, which, you know, creates districts where there are predominantly Republicans or Democrats, where you are not rewarded for compromise. In fact, you are punished for compromise.
Yeah.
So as a result, why would you go to Washington and attempt to make a deal with the other side when you're going to come back to your district and get hammered for it, and not just get hammered for it because of the substance of the policy, but because there are all these interest and advocacy groups that can throw millions and millions of dollars at you, accusing you of doing something that you might not even necessarily have done. So that's why the environment is so toxic.
You become a turncoat. You don't have. I mean, I hate to say, but look what Congressman Hanna went through. Towards the end, he was getting, and then ultimately endorsed Hillary Clinton. Well, you know that is not going to bode well with the base. It's certainly in a primary. You'll be okay in a general, but in the primary, you're going to get hammered.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, democracy is a living organism, and just because I think that they thought when they would gerrymander these districts that if I'm a Republican, I'll just continue to be elected as a Republican year after year. Well, all it did was move the democracy and the opportunity for people to have their voice to the primary stage. And in the primary, you have a very rabid and smaller group of people who are much more interested in the ideology of the party than they are necessarily the policy. And that's why you're getting the situation that you're getting now.
Well, here you now have Republicans in control. But because of, remember, this all started with the Tea Party, this divide in the Republican Party. Even when in control, they can't get anything done.
Yeah, but so when you say Republicans are in control, which Republicans are in control? You walk up the halls, and I really, it's almost like to a certain extent, Congress is turning into more of like the British parliamentary system, where you have all these different layers of these political parties, And, you know, you've got to build consensus among these wide factions of groups and build a coalition.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I wonder if we might reach a breaking point sometime in this election cycle. And I think a lot of it will have to do with the president's popularity. And, you know, he's still holding on to reasonably strong popularity in those hardcore Republican districts. But if he starts to fade in those Republican districts and, you know, he becomes such a toxic figure, that it, will there come a breaking point where, and it would happen on the Senate side first, where some of these moderate Republicans in swing states start to say, you know what, it might be more advantageous for me politically to team up with Democrats and actually get something done, even if it's counter to what the president wants, because that's what my constituents want. And so maybe that's when you start to see the tide turn. I still think we're a long way away from that right now.
That would be an unlikely majority that would occur right there.
Well, Democrats have no interest in working with Republicans.
Right,
you know,
we
shouldn't let Democrats off the hook here. I mean,
no, because they want it to fail so that they can be blamed on the Republicans, so they get back in office in 2 years.
Yeah, they're very much enjoying watching the Republicans flail around and unable to build consensus. The only thing that unites Democrats right now is their opposition to Donald Trump and Republicans in general. There are just as many factions of the Democratic Party, and it's just not being exposed right now. It likely will be when they get to the 2020 election and can't settle on someone to challenge Donald Trump. But yeah, I mean, both sides are dealing with turmoil right now. There's no doubt about that.
Finally, one quickie. New York's 22nd Congressional District, the congresswoman did an interview with USA Today, citing Lou Brindisi's past, alluding to organized crime. Her opponent, of course, is Anthony Brindisi, who is really, really popular here. Is that the fact that we're 16 months out? Is there any talk on Capitol Hill about midterms right now, and specifically the 22nd?
I know there is, yes, and I know that district in particular is specifically being targeted by the national parties from both sides.
Yeah.
In fact, I had a conversation not too long ago with some folks that are interested in that race very closely. I think that you guys are just at the front end right now. I mean, the stage that's being set right now reminds me a lot of what happened back in 2006. After Congressman Bullard stepped down and you had kind of a clash of the titans between Ray Meyer and Mike Arcuri.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think, not to say that the candidates are similar in that respect, but that the level of attention and interest that's going to be in this race over the next 18 months is going to be off the charts. You know, Democrats really feel like they have an opportunity to take back the House. They would need a district like the 22nd if they have any shot at taking back the House. So, yeah. It's just beginning, so you can either view that as good news or bad news for some.
Well, somebody yesterday said it might have been John Zibe. You're going to be wishing for your auto dealer commercials because they're going to be non-existent by the time we get up into once we get close, 6 months out. I mean, we're 16 months out, and the bickering is already underway.
Yeah, I feel bad for the Carbones and the Fusillos. What on earth are they going to do?
What are they going to do? They won't be able to get the time to buy. It's crazy. All right, Ryan, good stuff. Thanks so much. We appreciate it.
Thanks, guys. Have a great day.
Ryan Nobles with CNN.